But in a treetop, just a treetop, just a few feet away, there's little Robin singing a song. I don't know what
pray.
Yes.
Thank you. Jordan has just shared with us that every time we turn around,
yes.
keep on blessing.
Yes.
Over and over.
Yes.
And over.
Yes.
The fact that every breath we take is a blessing.
Yes.
We thank you. Every step we take is a blessing.
Yes.
The fact that we have eyes to see,
yes.
ears to hear,
yes.
nose to smell is a blessing.
Yes.
We just thank you. But most of all, we thank you for salvation.
Yes.
Yes. Jesus died and rose for our sin and salvation. And we just thank you. Pray now that you forgive me of my sin. Cleanse me from unrighteousness. Stand in my body. Thankful for my mind. Speak with my mouth. Let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, acceptable in my sight. The Lord, my strength and my redeemer. In Jesus' name. Every time I turn around.
Yes,
bless him.
Yes.
And it's just a continuous.
Yes, it is.
Oh, he blesses us. Sometimes we don't even recognize. He blesses. Amen. We don't recognize Mr. Potter, Bentley, Gibson, Pate, also Reverend Chambers here from Mount Moriah sharing with us today. Glad to see him.
Yes.
My old classmate. Good to see there's somebody here that looked 50. She just had a birthday the other day with that white hat over in the middle. Her and John from New York is here. The family, we're glad to see her. And I sent her a text the other day and said, if the kids know about the little hot date she was on. I'm just messing with her. I don't know if she was on one or not. I was trying to run interference. Before I read, I'm going to let Ricari know. I didn't see Richmond on Warren Central on the schedule this year, but we're going to beat y'all if we're on the schedule. I'm going to let you know that. I'm going to let you know in advance. Okay. All right. Isaiah 53, 1 through 12, and let's do this responsive reading style. I'll read the first verse and read the second. We'll continue to alternate until we get to verse 12, at which time we'll read that one together. Isaiah 53, 1 through 12 is the entire chapter. We're not going to make it through the entire chapter, but we're going to read it. We will have the Lord's Supper tonight at 5 o'clock. Isaiah 53, the entire chapter, verse 1 through 12. Responsive reading. I'll read first, you read second, and we'll continue alternating until we get to verse 12.
Amen.
Verse 1, who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not.
Surely he had borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted.
But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we're healed.
All like sheep go on astray. He has turned every one of his own way. And Lord, that he failed in the midst of his soul.
He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb. So he opened not his mouth.
He was fitting in the river of Judah.
And he made his grave with the wicked, with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was there any deceit in his mouth.
He
He shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. All together, therefore, I have a portion with the greater, and he shall divide the spoil of the stronger, because he hath poured out his soul unto the dead, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. Amen. May the Lord have blessing through reading, hearing, and doing of his word, and find our hearts to do the same. For a few moments, we want to talk about the paradox of Jesus, our wounded healer. The paradox of Jesus, our wounded healer. Can you say that? The paradox of Jesus, our wounded healer. Let me say very quickly, the word paradox is defined as a statement or a proposition that, despite sound reasoning, leads to a conclusion that seems senseless or self-contradictory. To the average mind, it makes no logical sense.
Yeah.
And when it comes to Jesus being our wounded healer, the minds of his skeptics and critics have had a hard time trying to make sense of this reality. How can one who is hurt heal?
Well,
how can one who is put out take us in?
Teach, Pastor, teach.
How can one who is cut cure?
Well,
how can one who is crucified make us a new creature?
Oh, no.
How can one who is beaten and broken,
all right, preacher,
unrecognizable as a human being, be a blessing? But despite all of that abuse,
it
took him being wounded for us to be healed.
Yeah.
Thus creating what we call a paradox.
Yeah.
The 53rd chapter of Isaiah stands out in the Old Testament as the single greatest prophecy of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And what he would accomplish for sinners.
Yes, yes, yes.
In this chapter, we learn about his life, verses 1-3. His death, verses 4-9. And his ultimate triumph, verses 10-12.
Right.
We're given a glimpse into the heart of God, and we see that he loves sinners to the degree that he was willing to pay the price of his life for our redemption. We're made to understand that this Jesus who died on Calvary, the very one who embodies the cry of John the Baptist from the Jordan River's banks, where he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God was come to take away the sin of the world."
All right.
Isaiah's prophecy is known as the Gospel of the Old Testament.
Yes.
And in this prophecy, we discover that a child is born, a son is given, and the government shall be on his shoulders. His name shall be called Wonderful.
Yes, sir.
Counselor.
Yes.
The Mighty God.
Yes.
The Everlasting Father.
Yes.
Prince of Peace.
Oh, yeah.
And of his kingdom and power, there is no end.
Yeah.
He's not only Isaiah, the offspring of David, he is the King.
Yeah.
Isaiah said that in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord high and lifted up, and his train
filled
the temple. He was so awesome that the seraphims had to cover their faces and their feet as they flew in his presence. And they were waiting expectantly to be dispatched to an assignment that he commanded them to go.
Yeah.
They recognized his holiness so much so that they cried, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory."
Yeah.
The doorposts in the temple moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke.
Yeah.
Isaiah said he saw those seraphims there doing the Lord's bidding, And then he says, woe is me.
Whoa.
For I am undone.
Whoa.
I'm a man of unclean lips.
Yes, sir.
And I dwell among the people of unclean lips.
Yes, sir.
For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts.
Yes, sir.
And then one of the seraphims took a live burning coal from off the altar and touched Isaiah's lips and said, your iniquity is purged and your sin forgiven.
Yeah.
And for the first time in that vision, Isaiah heard a voice that says, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? And Isaiah responded by saying, here am I, send me. Brothers and sisters, you're not going to be able to do much for the Lord until you're willing to let the Lord burn off some of the stuff in your life that keeps you from serving. From our lips, there should be a continuous chorus of hallelujahs for what the Lord has done for us.
Yeah.
But some of our problems include stuff that come from our lips.
Come on, man.
And some of that stuff is straight out of the pit of hell.
Yeah.
What do you mean, Pastor White? Lying.
Yeah.
Gossip.
Yeah.
Backbiting. And you do know all gossip is not necessarily a lie.
Yeah.
You're just talking about stuff you don't even talk about.
Yeah.
Evil speaking of one another.
Yeah.
And until some of that stuff is burned off, the Lord can't get much use out of it. But now Isaiah works his way up to our text today by saying, who has believed our report?
Yeah.
And then he says, and to whom has the arm of the Lord revealed?
Mm-hmm.
And then when he created the heaven and earth, he used his fingers.
Yeah.
When he delivered the children of Israel out of Egypt, he used his hand.
Yeah.
But to rescue us from our sin, he had to use his arm, or in other words, his strength.
Yeah.
Because to deliver us from our sin was more than creating the heaven and earth.
Yeah.
To save us from hell was more than getting Israel out of Egypt.
Well,
because God now becomes one of us in the person of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
He became sin for us who knew no sin, that we might become the righteousness of God in him.
Yeah.
Isaiah is the one that said that all of our righteousness is as filthy rag.
Yeah.
So our righteousness is insufficient, and our righteousness is only worthy of being counted as rubbish.
It's sufficient.
So we ought to be careful before we get beside ourselves. What we think is righteousness versus what God says is righteousness.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter how righteous you are, you're still subject to sin. Paul said, when I want to do good, evil is always present. He said, I do what I don't want to do, and I don't do what I should be doing. And just like Paul, we have a war going on the inside. So all of us need the strength of God, first of all, to save us, and then to sustain us after we're saved. So when we come to church, we need to realize that we're all in the same situation. We all need his love. We all need his grace. We all need his mercy. We all need his kindness. We all need his long suffering. We all need his patience. And thank God he's loving and patient with us. Because if the Lord delays his coming and you keep on living, every once in a while you're going to stumble and fall. Every now and then sin will get the upper hand on you. But we can go to him and confess our sin, and then he'll forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Is there anybody here that knows if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, where we
were?
So he created with his finger. He delivered Israel with his hand. But he saved me. He had to take his arm.
Yeah.
So who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? When Christ came, Israel was a dry ground.
Yeah.
It's in your Bible. Politically, it was a dry ground. Spiritually, it was a dry ground. But Christ came as a root and a tender plant,
a root
from a dry ground.
Come on, preacher. Come on, preacher.
Brothers and sisters, just sensibly, we know that roots and plants don't grow in dry ground.
No.
But when it comes to the Lord, he's not limited to nature.
Amen.
That lets us know that if there's a dry spot in your life, the Lord can do
he's
something
about it. He's not limited, Pastor.
If you don't believe me, Job had some dry spots.
Yes.
And the Lord asked Job in the 38th chapter, who makes the rain fall on a barren land? In a desert where nobody lives. Who sends the rain to satisfy the parched ground? To make the tender grass spring up. Then he said to Job, does rain have a father? Who gives birth to the dew? Who is the mother of ice? Who gives birth to the frost?
Come on,
water turns the ice as hard as a rock.
Yeah.
And the surface of the water freezes.
Yes,
but Job, can you shout to the clouds and make it rain? Job will tell you that the Lord is not limited to dry spells.
Yeah.
And there's somebody in this room today
that has
some dry spells in your life. Some dry spells in your church, in your prayer life.
Yeah.
And you try to pray and your mind is wondering. Is anybody here?
Yeah.
I mean, you really mean to
call
the Lord. And before you know it, your mind is way across time. And you get up from your prayers feeling dry. Maybe your finances are dry. You decided you didn't like the direction that the church is going in. So you decided to rob God and withhold the Lord's tithes and offerings. And now your finances have dried up. The late Reverend James Coffey of the Community Baptist Church of Santa Rosa, California used to say, when your outgo is more than your income, then your upkeep will be your downfall. Dried up.
Yeah.
You're experiencing what Haggai said to the people, where he alludes to the wages that you earn
of
like money being put in a bag. Put holes in it.
Yeah.
You have it, you got the money, but you don't keep it long because there are holes in the bag. And the Lord said, you look for much harvest, but when you brought it home, it was little because I blew it away.
Yeah.
And the reason I blew it away is because you left my house in ruin.
Yeah.
Dried up. Maybe your marriage. You don't have time to invest
in your marriage.
And you wonder why it's so dry. No cultivation. No watering. No tenderness. No care, no affection,
dried up.
Yeah. But thank God for Jesus, because the Lord can let a tender plant
and
root grow up in that dry ground.
Yeah.
Because it's not about you, it's about him.
Yeah.
And if you put him first, he'll sweeten up your bitter life.
Yeah.
For the word says that there's no beauty, no form of comeliness.
Mm-hmm.
They were looking for him to come riding on a horse, but he came in a horse trough. They were looking for him to be decked out in jewels and splendor, but he was wrapped in swaddling clothes. He spoke of his own homeless dilemma, Caroline, where he says, foxes have holes, birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. He wasn't even eligible for Section 8.
Come out, preacher! Come out, preacher!
Nowhere to lay his head.
Yes, sir! Yes, sir! Yes, sir!
He was willing to come and live in this world in poverty. And he was willing to surround himself with common men and sinners so his beauty might be seen. But born to peasant parents.
Yeah.
Poverty was his running buddy.
Come on, Pastor.
His disciples were common fishermen. Common peasants were his most devoted followers. And his death was among the condemned and wretched. But the real beauty of Jesus lies not in what men can see, but rather by what he has done.
Yeah.
So we ought to dismiss from our mind these artists' renderings of their perception of what they think Jesus looked like. And since he was not comely, but appeared common, the world refused to follow him. And the reason the world can't follow him is because they were looking for some military general. They were looking for some powerful and charismatic figure that comes to them with the answer to all of life's riddles. But Christ says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Christ comes to the lowly. He comes to the meek. He comes to the humble and those who are pure in heart. To those who are hungering and thirsting after righteousness. He's not always in the big things or in the big house. You can often meet him in the slave quarters. He's not always into those who have money and influence. Matter of fact, the slave quarters, a lot of the songs that from way back in the day have come out of that situation. Even though they were beaten all day long, they were singing songs like, I got a feeling, everything's gonna be all right. They say songs like, swing low, sweet chariot. Why don't you stop by and let me ride? They sing songs like, up above my head, I hear music in the air. There must be a God somewhere. That's why they met at the end of their quarter, as they tended to one another with bruises and blood and put a salve on cuts from the whips. But sometimes he's in the man on the street with nowhere to live. Believe it or not, he's not always in the church. Because if you're not careful, you'll discover that the church has some of the meanest people in the world.
Yes, we do. Meanest people.
And in the minds of some of them, Jesus is not welcome even in his own church. Did you not know that some of the most hateful people in Richmond stop by Mount Olive every once in a while? And if you don't think they're hateful, you mess around and sit in their seat next Sunday.
Come on, Pastor.
Move on. So he's a tender plant. He's a root out of dry ground. But if you learn to put him first, he'll bring some warmth into that cold place in your cold situation. But surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. We esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Now, one of the most misrepresented passages of scripture in the Bible is verse 5. It's often quoted, but most misrepresented. It says, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we healed. And the reason why it's misrepresented is that some people present it as healing for your physical body. And they're saying if you love God, you'll never be sick. Because all you have to do is claim the word by his stripes, we're healed. But the context of the passage is not talking about physical healing. About when Jesus was here in the flesh, he didn't heal everybody. And even today, he won't heal everybody from a physical standpoint. Some people, like my mother, were called to what I call the ministry of suffering. So because you're sick does not mean you're not a Christian.
That's right.
God can use your sickness to give you a strong testimony. Sometimes God will enroll saints in the school of suffering. The text is talking about salvation. By his stripes we're healed. Does that mean when I go to the hospital and get out that I'm better off? God may choose to leave me afflicted. Because he may be able to get greater glory out of my life with me limping. If you don't believe me, ask Jacob. He spent the rest of his life limping after that all-night wrestling encounter with an angel. Paul spent the rest of his life with a thorn in the flesh. He prayed the Lord remove the thorn on three different occasions. But God said, no, my grace is sufficient. My strength is made perfect in me. And it might be somebody here today that has some residue from your past life. And God ain't gonna remove it. Now some of the younger people know what residue means.
Yeah,
that smoke weed, that have your thumb and your index finger burn up because you didn't have a roach clip. That's residue. I'm trying to get on your street. That God not gonna remove because He wants to use it to help you with your handicap. Think about it. God got you out of that unhealthy relationship. But you have the residue of that relationship all over you. Emotional and psychological scars that remind you of where He brought you from. There's some decision that you made that you wish you hadn't made. There's some roads you traveled that you wish you hadn't traveled. But the Lord will bring them up every now and then. So to remind you of where He brought you from. And if you forget where you came from, He may have to do like He did the children of Israel in Psalm 137.
Yes, sir.
By the rivers of Babylon.
Yes.
Then we sat down. Yeah, we wept.
Yes.
When we remembered Zion.
Yes.
We hanged our hearts upon the willows in the midst thereof.
Yes.
For they that carried us captive required us of a song.
Yes.
And they wasted us and required of us myrrh.
Preach it, Pastor.
Saying, sing us one of the song of Zion.
Yes.
And then the question, how shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? And then the verse says, if I forget thee, O God, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth.
Yeah.
We need to be careful that we don't forget the Lord and what He's done for us. But we ought not forget that when we were drunk and don't know how we got home, how the Lord brought us. We ought not forget that there have been some days when people were looking for you for days on end and they finally found you in a crack house. We ought not forget the time that you've been in a nightclub with the lights turned down, whispering sweet nothing to somebody that wasn't your husband or your wife. Don't forget. When we showed up at church, our clothes bright but our hearts dark. The Lord was so merciful that He didn't take us out of here. Chastisement that Jesus had to endure. The death on the cross, the most horrible form of execution known to man. Well, that's where the word excruciating is derived from. When a man was crucified on the cross, tremendous strain was exerted from his wrists, arms, and shoulders, usually resulting in the dislocation of his shoulders and elbow joints. Arms being held up and out, held the rib cage in a fixed position and made it extremely difficult to exhale. Totally impossible to take a full breath. That sounds like a sermon, Minister Paul. Waiting to exhale. The victim would only be able to take very shallow breaths. As time passed, the muscles from the loss of blood, loss of oxygen, and the fixed position of the body would undergo severe cramps and contraction. Suffocation was the ultimate cause of death on the cross. Because of the position of the body, the muscles in the chest would be contracted, forcing the dying man to push against the nails in his feet, to raise up enough to try to take a breath. And after a time through exhaustion, the victim would no longer be able to raise himself to exhale. Then suffocation and that process would increase. Normally, heart failure due to the accumulation of fluid resulted in cardiac arrest. The death of Jesus was a horrible. So His death and resurrection is the healing balm for the sin sick soul. Isaiah says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on Him the iniquity of us all.
Yes, sir.
Everybody in here is like sheep going astray.
Yes, yeah.
Brother and sister, there's some days when we don't act like we're Christians.
Yes.
There's some seasons in our lives when we don't even look redeemed.
Yes.
And sometimes, like sheep, we get in lockstep with wrong.
Yes.
I don't care how much you shout. All of us, like sheep,
yes,
have gone astray.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there have been times when we've turned to our own way.
Yeah.
And for that reason, the Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all.
Yeah.
And then when you read the rest of Isaiah 53, you'll see he is a lamb led to the slaughter. He was brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep becoming shearers, being dumb, not saying a word.
Yeah.
But let me hear heaven say, he may have been a sheep here, but before the chapter's over, he becomes a shepherd. And for those of us who have strayed away from him,
yeah,
we ought to thank God that we have a shepherd who
seeks
after us. He comes looking for us.
Yes.
No matter where you are, he's coming to find you.
Yes.
No matter what you've done, the Lord is coming to find you.
Yes.
You may be trying to hide behind the rubble and debris of your sin.
Yes.
But the shepherd loves you. He'll pick you up out of the trash heaps of
yes.
life.
Yes.
Nobody else can do it like Jesus did.
Yes.
That's why I believe David said, the Lord is my shepherd.
Yes.
I shall not.
Breathe.
He makes me to lie down in green pastures.
Yeah.
He leadeth me beside the still water.
Yeah.
He restoreth my soul.
Yeah.
He leadeth me in the path of righteousness
yeah.
for his name's sake.
Yeah.
Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil.
Yeah.
For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff. Yeah, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thank God for the shepherd. Thank God that he seeks me out. Is there anybody here who has gone astray?
Yes.
Is there anybody here who's gotten off into some stuff
yes.
that you wish you hadn't gotten into?
Yes.
Is there anybody here who is a riddle with you?
Come on, Pastor.
And shame over some activity in
yes.
your life?
Yes.
Is there anybody here who has dark days? I've got good news for you. I got a new remix that I wrote. And if your days have been dark, let me tell you what I wrote. I've got sunshine on a cloudy day. When it's cold outside, I've got the month of May. I guess you say, who can make me feel this way? Power in the name of Jesus. Do you have some? wounded healer.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you for healing that comes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Cross. And the fact that you did what you did by your death and resurrection. We have spiritual healing.
Yes.
We thank you. Thank you that we have salvation regardless of what happened to us physically, and we'll someday have new glorified bodies.
Yes.
And we thank you. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with us now and forever. Shall we all say together? Amen. I love you, there's nothing you can do about it.